You gonna look like Franklin Saint in the finale.
Give up, bro. I hope we made peace with that day too. Okay, bro. He went out crazy. That day was wild.
That day was wild for sure. Sabbath peace. Another opportunity for us to come together and hear and learn of the word of truth that is given to us by the Most High God. All honor goes to the Father through the Son, whose name is Yahushua. In him lies the only hope for salvation. We know that it is obtained by grace through faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast, and given freely as a gift to all who obey him. We understand that if you do not obey him, it is made manifest or made obvious that you do not believe. In this state, you should expect no good thing from the Most High. However, anything that you do get, whether it be a gift of tongues, a gift of prophecy, or any supernatural experience that you may have, it can and it will be used against us in the day of judgment. With that said, peace to the saints that are in the room, to the saints that couldn't make it, to the saints watching in on the TV, saints that, you know what I'm saying, around the world that we don't even know about, but no peace to the wicked. The only thing we say to them is repent that they might live. That's right, boy. Hey, tell everybody that can read to come on up in here. Thought y'all can try to ease out, huh? Mm-hmm. The guy messed it up for y'all. Look at it. You almost got away with it if it wasn't for that raggedy kid, huh? Get your butt in here. You heard what I said. What's wrong with you? Get your butt down. That wasn't me. Yeah, Earl, too. All right. He got away. That's the trick. You got to follow. You gotta fall asleep before it gets started. That's, you know what I'm saying? That's how you do it. Sit your butt down. Stop. I don't even want to hear nothing. Hey, hush. Sit your butt down. You ain't gonna do nothing. Go to sleep on the couch. Don't leave no dent in my couch either. Mm-hmm. This is last week. Last week we talked about King Josiah. So if we look here on the board here, it's at the bottom left. Let me see if I can make it bigger. But he at the bottom left. He was our king. And we read a little bit about Nahum, right? And Nahum was a prophet of, where is it here? Nahum was a prophet of Nineveh, actually. Okay, boom, zoom in. We're going to zoom in right here. So Nahum was a prophet of Nineveh, and he was prophesying that Nineveh was going to get taken down. So we read a little bit about it. We read the first chapter of Nahum. And then we kind of stopped there. But there's actually a lot more. So if you look at all the prophets, right, you have Nahum. Let's look at it. So Nahum, you got Joel, Jeremiah, Zephaniah, and Habbakkuk, all in the time of Josiah. So we just read how Josiah, you remember the king of Egypt, Necho, down here. He was, you know what I'm saying? He started to ride out, and he was trying to get at the king of Assyria up here, right? So he was trying to get at the king of Assyria up here. This is Necho. Josiah didn't like that. He was too close to the, you know what I'm saying, too close to home. So Josiah ended up trying to get at Necho. Necho killed Josiah. Then we talked a little bit about Nahum, and he gave us a few prophecies. So now we're going to continue on. And let's discuss a little bit more about some of the other prophets. And we'll probably tie back into Nahum as well. But let's try to look at some of the other prophets. So in the let's look at Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 1. This is Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 1. Not yet.
Word of the Lord, which came unto Zephaniah, the son of Cushai, the son of Gedaliah, the son of Amariah, the son of Hezekiah, in the days of Josiah, the son of Ammon, king of Judah.
Right. So you can see here, the scripture is telling us he prophesied in the days of Josiah. Right? Jump on over to chapter 2. This is Zephaniah chapter 2, verse 1.
Gather yourself together. Gather together, O nation, not desired. Before the decree bring forth, before the day pass as the chaff, before the fierce anger of Yahuwah come upon you, before the day of the Lord's anger come upon you. Seek ye the Lord, and all ye meek of the earth, which have wrought his judgment. Seek righteousness, seek meekness. It may be ye shall be hid in the day of Yahuwah's anger.
Mm-hmm.
For Gaza shall be forsaken, and Ashkelon, excuse me, and Ashkelon the desolation.
They shall right, when they say Gaza and Ashkelon, that's the places where them people is fighting right now. Right? That's where the Jewish people, right? That's what they attacking people in Gaza and Ashkelon right now. Right? So he said, Gaza is going to be forsaken in Ashkelon, right? Keep going.
They shall drive out Ashdod at the noonday, and Ekron mm-hmm. shall be rooted up. Woe unto the inhabitants of the seacoast, the nation of the Kerethites. The word of Yahuwah is against you, O Canaan, the land of the Philistines. I will even destroy thee, that there shall be no inhabitant.
Mm-hmm.
The seacoast shall be dwellings and cottages for shepherds and folds for flocks. And the coast shall be for the remnant of the house of Judah. They shall feed thereupon. In the houses of Ashkelon shall they lie down in the evening. For Yahuwah their God shall visit them and turn away their captivity.
Right. So the scripture is telling us that whole land is going to be ours. Right. This is what the Jewish people, when they read and try to justify the stuff that they're doing over there, this is what they try to use to justify what they're doing, because they would have you believe that they're the descendants. They're not going to ever say it flat out. You'll never see no Jewish person jump on TV and be like, I am a descendant of the, I'm a physical descendant of the Israelites, because they know it's not that simple. Right. But they try to just, they try to just cleverly say things like they the people of God, or they're God's nation, or things like that, to make people believe that they're saying that they're descendants without actually ever having to say it. But they're not the descendants. We are the descendants, right? That's why we're in our captivity at this point. We're in our captivity because our fathers, our ancestors that came before us, disobeyed God, right? And that's what this is all about, right? It's about bringing us together, having us educated about the word of the Most High God, so we have an opportunity to turn and put our face back towards God, and the Most High God forgive us and our ancestors. All right, keep going.
I have heard the reproach of Moab and the revelings of the children of Ammon, whereby mm-hmm. they have reproached my people and magnified themselves against their border. Therefore, mm-hmm. as I live, says Yahuwah of hosts, the God of Israel, surely Moab shall be as Sodom, and the children of Ammon as Gomorrah, even the breeding of nettles in salt pits, and a perpetual desolation. The residue of my people shall spoil them, and the remnant of my people shall possess them. This shall they have for their pride, because they have reproached and magnified themselves against the people of Yahuwah hosts. Yahuwah will be terrible unto them, for he will famish all the gods of the earth, and men shall worship him, everyone from his place, even all the isles of the heathen. Ye Ethiopians also, ye shall be slain by the sword, and he shall stretch out his hand against and destroy Assyria, and will make Nineveh a desolation, and will dry like a wilderness.
Right? So you remember, Assyria has been the big bad wolf for us. Right? Don't you remember when Assyria, they had us besieged? Right? And we thought we was going to be taken down. Even before that, there was a threat that the king of Israel and the king of Syria, not Assyria, but the king of Syria, Damascus, right? That they were going to team up together against Judah. And Judah called the king of Assyria. And the king of Assyria ended up coming out and taking the king of Israel and all his land. And he took all Damascus and all their land. Right? Then after that, they besieged Judah. Circled them about. Right? And then they stopped all food from coming in, anything from going out. So after a while, water started to dry up. You know what I'm saying? Then you start trying to make peace. Like, hold on, man. We all right. You know what I'm saying? We need to eat around here. We can't go hunt. We can't go get no food. Whatever we got already in here, we stuck with it. And that's only going to last for so long. So you do that until people give up. Until they say, okay, look, we surrender. We'll do whatever you want us to do. Just don't let us starve to death in here. Right? They besieged it, but the Most High God saved us. Remember, he killed all the soldiers when they was outside of the gates. We woke up one day, they was all just dead. right? Then he ended up having the king of Assyria ended up being killed by his sons. So then his sons took over, and now they're the king. Right. But the Most High God is telling us by the mouth of the prophet Zephaniah that he going to go read it again. Watch this.
And he will stretch out his hand against the north and destroy Assyria and will make Nineveh a desolation and dry like a wilderness.
Mm-hmm.
The flock shall lie down in the midst of her, and all the beasts of the nations, both of the cormorant and the bittern, shall lodge in the upper lintels of it. Their voice shall sing in the windows. Desolation shall be in the thresholds, for he shall uncover the cedar work. This is the rejoicing city that dwelt carelessly, that said in her heart, I am, and there is none besides me. How has she become a desolation, a place for beasts to lie down in? Everyone that passes by her shall hiss and wag his hand.
All right. So it's telling us that Assyria, who is at the top of the game, everybody going to be looking at it like, man, I remember when Assyria was running stuff. How in the world did this become a desolation? In other words, how'd the whole thing get destroyed? Right? But that's the same thing that Nahum was talking about. Right? Nahum was he was prophesying to us, and he was letting us know that, man, this thing ain't about to last long. Watch, let's finish out Nahum. Let's go to I think we read chapter 1, but let's skip to chapter 3. This is Nahum chapter 3. Nahum was trying to tell us that. He's like, yeah, it's over for Assyria.
Woe to the bloody city. Woe to the bloody city. It is full of lies and robbery. They pray, departeth not. The noise of a whip and the noise of the rattling of the wheels and of the prancing horses and all of the jumping chariots. The horseman lifteth up both bright sword and the glittering spear. And there is a multitude of slain and a great number of carcasses. And there is none end of their corpses. They stumble upon their corpses. Because of the multitude of the whoredoms of the well-favored hearted, the mistress of witchcrafts that sells nations through her whoredoms and families through her witchcrafts. Behold, I am against thee, says Yahuwah of hosts, and I will discover thy skirts upon thy face, and I will show the nations thy nakedness and thy kingdoms thy shame.
And I will. Right, this is very similar to the language that's used for mystery Babylon in many of the prophets, including Revelation. Right. Very similar language. So you have to look at that and you have to think about, OK, how does Assyria go down and how does that play out for mystery Babylon since similar language is used? Keep going.
And I will cast abominable filth upon thee and make thee vile and will set thee as a gazing stock. And it shall come to pass that all they that look upon thee shall flee from thee and say, Nineveh is laid waste. Who will bemoan her? Whence shall I seek comforters for thee? Art thou better than populous? No, that was situate among the rivers that had the waters round about it, whose rampart was the sea, and her wall was from the sea. Ethiopia and Egypt were her strength, and it was infinite. Put and Lubim were thy helpers, yet was she carried away. She went into captivity. Her young children also were dashed in pieces at the top of all the streets, and they cast lots for her honorable men. And all her great men were bound in chains. Thou also shalt be drunken. Thou shalt be hid. Thou shalt seek strength because of the enemy. All thy strongholds shall be like fig trees with the first ripe figs. If they be shaken, they shall even fall into the mouth of the eater. Behold, thy people in the midst of thee are women. The gates of thy land shall be set wide, wide open unto thine enemies. The fire shall devour thy bars. Draw thee waters for the seas. Fortify thy strongholds. Go into clay and tread the mortar. Make strong the brickland. There shall the fire devour thee. The sword shall cut thee off. It shall eat thee up like a cankerworm. Make thyself many as the cankerworm. Make thyself many as the locust. Thou hast multiplied thy merchants above the stars of heaven. The cankerworm spoils and flies away. Thou crowned are as the locusts, and thy captains are as great grasshoppers, which camp in the hedges of the cold day. But when the sun arises, they flee away, and their place is not known where they are. Thy shepherds slumber, O king of Assyria. Thy nobles shall dwell in the dust.
Right? Thy nobles, right? In other words, the strong people, right? The valiant men, right? He said, they are going to dwell in the dust. In other words, these boys about to die, right? Keep going.
Thy people is scattered upon the mountains, and no man gathers them. There is no healing of thy bruise. Thy wound is grievous, and all that hear the bruit of thee shall clap their hands over thee. For upon whom has not thy wickedness passed continually? That's it.
So that's Nahum, right? Nahum is trying to let us know also, he's telling us, you have to make sure that you have all the information because Assyria is about to go down, right? He was sent to Assyria to talk, right? But Zephaniah, who was sent to Judah, he was saying the same thing, like, nah, man, Assyria about to go down. He was saying that to us. Nahum was saying it directly to Assyria, right? He was saying it to us, though, Zephaniah was. Right? But it's not, you see all these prophets at one time, we already know because Amos told us, the Most High God tells it to the prophet before something big happens. Right? So that's why all these prophets are around, but they all saying the same thing. Right? So if we look on the board, there's another prophet. His name is Habbakkuk. Right? Let's go to Habbakkuk chapter 1, verse 1. I just want y'all to see how they all talking about Assyria. They all saying the same thing. You got to imagine yourself in this time period throughout the life of Josiah. You have all this. Imagine. Remember, Josiah, he started tearing stuff down that didn't have nothing to do with the Most High God. He burned the priest's bones on the altar. Right. He started rebuilding the temple, trying to get things together, collecting money from people, even the people that were scattered out, the Israelites that were scattered out with the northern tribes. Right. He went and collected money from them to build the temple back up. So at the same time that all this stuff is happening, you have different prophets popping up all over the place, giving people the word of the Most High God, saying, yo, 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 X, Y, and Z is going to happen. This is how X, Y, and Z is going to play out. And every one of them is talking about how Assyria is about to be out of here. Right? That's important. Keep going. Habbakkuk chapter 1, verse 1.
The burden which Habbakkuk the prophet did see. O Yahuwah, how long shall I cry and thou will not hear? Even cry unto thee of violence and thou will not save. Why dost thou show me iniquity and cause me to behold grievance? For spoiling and violence are before me, and there are that rise up strife and contention. Therefore the law is slacked, and judgment does never go forth, for the wicked does compass about the righteous, therefore wrong judgment proceeds. Behold ye among the heathen in regard and wonder marvelously, for I will work a work in your days which ye will not believe.
Look, he said, I will work a work in your days which you will not believe. Then he come back and he say, even though somebody told you it. Keep going.
For lo, is of the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation which shall march through the breadth of the land.
Listen, now when he say Chaldeans, it's important now. When he say Chaldeans, he's talking about the Babylonians. Right? So when he says Chaldeans, he's talking about Babylon. Remember, Babylon is the same nation that showed up to Hezekiah's house and was like, show me everything. All right, they didn't say that, but Hezekiah ended up showing them everything. Right? And then the prophet Isaiah told Hezekiah, he like, yeah, well, because you showed them, they're going to take it all. But he said, it ain't going to happen in your day. It's going to happen in your son's day. Hezekiah was like, I accept that. You know what I'm saying? That thing's all right with me. You know what I'm saying? It's going to happen in my son's day. That's all right with me. You know what I'm saying? I ain't even going to complain about that one. But then later on, you have Manasseh, right? Manasseh was taken by the Babylonians, taken captive by the Babylonians. Right. And then he was released and he went back and he repented to the Most High God. So you see, the Babylonians are starting to rise at this point. So now you see the book from the mouth of Habbakkuk. He's saying, listen, it's going to be something to happen and you're not going to believe it. Even if somebody told you this, you're not going to believe it. The Chaldeans. Watch what the Chaldeans. See, read it again. Watch what the Chaldeans going to do.
For lo, I raise up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation, which shall march through the breadth of the land to possess the dwelling places that are not theirs. They are terrible and dreadful. Their judgment and their dignity shall proceed of themselves. Their horses also are swifter than the leopards and are more fierce than the evening wolves. And their horsemen shall spread themselves, and their horsemen shall come from far. They shall fly as the eagle that flies to, that hastens to eat. They shall come all for violence. Their faces shall stir up as the east wind, and they shall gather the captivity of the sand as the sand. They shall scoff at the kings, and the princes shall be a scorn unto them. They shall deride every stronghold, for they shall heap dust and take it. Then shall his mind change, and he shall pass over and offend.
This is important. I want y'all to see this. These are prophets telling you how this thing is about to play out. But there's details in here that a lot of people miss. He said, then shall his mind change. Read that part again.
Then shall his mind change, and he shall pass over and offend, imputing this his power unto his God.
Right? So listen, there is going to be a king that we're going to read about. His name is Nebuchadnezzar. He's going to be running the darn show. He going to think he the highest of kings. The king of kings is what he going to call himself. Right? And then after that, his mind is going to change. The Most High God is going to curse him to the ground. And then his mind is going to change. And he going to actually start serving the Most High God. That's what this is talking about. When it says he going to impute it to himself. And then he going to give glory to his Elohim. Right? That's saying his own God. His God. My God is what that's talking about. When it say Eloah, that's talking about my God. Read it again.
Then shall his mind change, and he shall pass over and offend, imputing this his power unto his God.
Right?
Art thou not from everlasting, O Yahuwah, my God, my Holy One? We shall not die, O Lord. Thou hast ordained them for judgment. And mighty, O God, thou hast established them for correction. Thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil and cannot look upon iniquity.
Wherefore, right. So now look, listen to Habbakkuk now. Habbakkuk is now talking to Most High God. So he went, at first we were reading a prophecy, right? And it was a prophecy saying, yo, this is how the Chaldeans is going to come out. But listen, at the end of it, the man is going to change his mind. And then he's going to start giving glory to the Most High God. That's what he's saying. Right. He's going to start giving glory to the Most High God. He's going to change his mind and start giving glory to God. So then after that, Habakkuk start kind of like praising the Most High God. Like, man, listen, man, you got some pure eyes. I mean, you can't even look at iniquity. But then watch the question that he asked.
Thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil and cannot look upon iniquity. Wherefore lookest thou upon them that deal treacherously? And holdest thy tongue when the wicked devour the man that is more righteous than he.
Right. So he said, now, listen, I believe that you are pure eyes and you can't even look at iniquity. But explain something to me, God. How in the world do you see all this stuff going on and you hold your tongue? You ain't said nothing about it. Right. That's the question that he had. Now watch how Habakkuk continued.
And make his men as the fishes of the sea, as the creeping things that have no ruler over them. Pick up all of them with the angle. They catch them in their net and gather them in their drag. Therefore, they rejoice and are glad. Therefore, they sacrifice unto their net and burn incense unto their drag, because by them their portion is fat and their meat plenteous. So they therefore empty their net and not spare continually to slay the nations.
So he's saying, his question is pretty much, how do you give these wicked people power to destroy all these other nations and all these people? He said, how do you do it? I know that you can't look on evil. And I know this stuff bothers you. How in the world do you hold your tongue while all these kings get up and they conquer all these nations and be killing all these people and they wicked? They don't serve you. You know what I'm saying? They got their own God. He looked like, how do you allow this to happen? Watch what he say in chapter 2.
I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower and will watch to see what he will say unto me. And I shall answer when I am reproved.
Right. So he said, listen, I know that I asked you a question and I know I'm about to get corrected in what I just said. So I'm just going to sit back. You know what I'm saying? And when you teach me, you know what I'm saying, what I didn't know, I'm going to give you an answer. Right? He said, I'm going to answer when I, because he already knew. He said, I'm asking this question, but I know enough scripture and I know enough about the Most High God to know that I'm going to ask this question and he's going to have something to say and I'm going to learn from it and I'm going to be corrected in what I'm thinking. Right? He's looking for that correction. Watch this. Keep going. Watch how the Most High God responds to him.
And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold,
right? So the Most High God is telling him, he's, look, you have, I love the Most High God because a lot of people don't, Habbakkuk is freaking out. You got to understand what just happened. Habbakkuk was given a vision. And Habbakkuk said, you know what? This is what's going to happen. The Chaldeans going to come out. Boy, them boys got some bad horses. They're going to be running around. Them boys strong. You can't do nothing with them. They're going to tear some stuff up. They're going to take over everything. He talking about the Chaldeans. Right now, the Chaldeans ain't on the map like that. I mean, they strong, but they ain't strong like he's describing. Right? He looked like, man, it's about to get rough, and it's the Chaldeans that I'm seeing in my vision. Then he continue on. He like, oh, and then he going to change his mind eventually, and he gonna attribute this stuff, and he going to impute it to his God. Okay, cool. Then after that, he's looking like, okay, so God, why you keep letting this happen? You got the Assyrians, and now you telling me that the Chaldeans about to do what the Assyrians been doing? So he like, God, why you keep letting this happen? I know you're not comfortable with evil like this. So why does it keep happening? That was his question. Why do you keep letting this happen? What's God's response? Write that thing down that I just told you. Because it's for a point in time. Oh, it's going to happen. In other words, everything you just said is going to happen. Right? It's for a point in time. But it's going to happen. Wait for it. Because it ain't going to wait. Right? Read it again. Watch this. Watch his response.
For the vision,
and YAHUAH said what?
For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold, his soul which
when is... When it say tarry, it means wait.
Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith.
Right? So he says his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him. Right? In other words, the king of Babylon, who's going to be lifted up as king, his soul is not right. But he's saying, listen, the just are going to live by faith. So in other words, it's going to look bad. But the only way you're going to get through this is if you believe in my word. That's why he's saying, write this stuff down and give it to him. Because it's going to happen. Everything that I'm telling you is going to happen. And the only way you're going to live is if you believe in the word of the Most High God. The just shall live by faith. It's what Paul quoted. Right? Keep going. Watch this.
Yea, also because he transgresseth by wine, he is a proud man. Neither does he keep at home, who enlarges his desire as hell and is as death and cannot be satisfied, but gathered unto him all nations, heaps unto him all people. Are not all these take up a parable against him and a taunting proverb against him and say, woe to him that increases that which is not his. How long? And to him that ladeth himself with thick clay. Shall they not rise up suddenly that shall bite thee and awake that shall vex thee? And thou shalt be for bodies unto them. Booty, and thou shalt be for booties unto them. Because thou hast.
In other words, that's talking about spoil. So that's talking about, remember we talk about when you win a war, you get to take everything that nation had. So they call that spoil or booty, right? That means you taking it. You get to take all they stuff, right? Keep going. Watch this.
Because thou hast spoiled many nations, all the remnant of the people shall spoil thee because of men's blood and for the violence of the land, of the city, and of all that dwell therein. Woe to him that covers an evil covetousness to his house, that he may set his nest on high, that he may be delivered from the power of evil. Thou hast consulted shame to thy house by cutting off many people and has sinned against thy soul.
He's talking to the king of Babylon at this point, right? So he said, you brought all these people in and you cut off a lot of people. And because of that, you've consulted shame. In other words, you made a deal with shamefulness, right? Keep going.
For the stone shall cry out of the wall, and the beam out of the timber shall answer it. Woe to him that builds a town with blood and satisfies a city by establishes a city by iniquity. Behold, is it not of Yahuwah of hosts that the people shall labor in the very fire, and the people shall weary themselves for very vanity?
Mm-hmm.
For the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of Yahuwah, as the waters covered the sea. Woe unto them, unto him that giveth his neighbor drink, and puts thy bottle to him, and make him drunken also, that thou may look upon their nakedness. Thou art filled with shame for glory. Drink thou also. Let thy foreskin be uncovered. The cup of the Lord's right hand shall be turned unto thee, and shameful spewing shall be on the glory, thy glory. For the violence of Lebanon shall cover thee, and the spoil of beasts which made them afraid because of men's blood, and for the violence of the land of the city and all that dwell therein. What profited the graven image that the maker thereof has graven it, the molten image and the teacher of lies, that the maker of his work trusted therein to make dumb idols? Woe unto him that says to the wood, awake, and the dumb stone, arise, it shall teach. Behold, it is laid over with gold and silver, and there is no breath in it at all in the midst of it. But Yahuwah is his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him.
All right, so Yahuwah saying, y'all sitting here playing with these idols, right? And Babylon is going to try to exalt all these idols. The idols are dumb. They don't have no souls in them. They say, Yahuwah, look, he in this set apart temple, right? So he said, everybody else need to be quiet, right? So what it's showing you is, it's kind of hinting. We know how it's going to play out, but it's kind of hinting. Not only is Assyria going to go down, but the Babylonians are going to rise to power and kind of take the place of Assyria. So when Habakkuk is seeing this vision, he's looking like, what gives? You know what I'm saying? You mean to tell me we about to get off from underneath the Assyrians, and then you going to put another nation, another wicked nation? Because Habakkuk would know what they did to Manasseh. Talking about our king Manasseh. He would know about that. So he's looking like, you going to put another wicked nation over us and give them all the power? Why do you keep doing it? Like, listen, I'm going to ask this question. I'm going to sit back and I'm going to see how I'm corrected, in other words. I'm going to see how I turn out. I just need to ask this question. So the Most High God answered him. First thing he said is, everything you saw is going to happen. Right? Because his question is, why do you do it? Most High God is like, it's going to happen. Write it down. It ain't no lie. It's going to happen. Just like I said, it was going to happen. And the just going to live by faith, boy. You have to pay attention. When people in the scripture ask Yah a question, you have to pay very close attention to how he responds. Because that sets you up. When you got questions for the Most High God, it sets you up with the right expectation. If you think the Most High God is going to appear, you know what I'm saying, appear to you while you looking in the mirror and start giving you a vision of comfort. Everything's going to be all right. Just be strong, my son. Be strong, my daughter. That's our imagination that be having that. That's not how Most High God talked to these people when they ask a question. When the question is asked, the Most High God is direct and straight. I don't care about nothing about your question. This is what I need done. It's all about focus. And when we get to the gospel and we see Yahushua walking around, it's the same way. It's focus. It's get to it. What is the root of the problem? How do we address it? All the rest of this stuff is just emotions, or it's just stuff pulling the side to side, or people manipulating us. No, not the Most High God. Most High God trying to get right to it. Focus on what you need to, because if you focus on that, you'll get through everything else. Let's see. This is 2 Kings chapter 23. Give me verse 31. 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 31. All right. So Josiah died. Josiah had a king, a son named Jehoahaz that became king. So we about to read about Jehoahaz.
Jehoahaz was 23 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 3 months in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Hamutal, the daughter of Jeremiah of Libna. And he did that which was evil in the sight of Yahuwah, according to all that his fathers had done. And Pharaoh Necho put him in bands at Riblah, in the land of Hamath, that he might not reign in Jerusalem, and put the land to a tribute of 100 talents of silver and 1 talent of gold. Pharaoh Necho made Eliakim, the son of Josiah, king in the room of Josiah, his father, and turned his name to Jehoiakim, and took Jehoahaz away, and he came to Egypt and died there.
Right? So remember something about the king of Egypt. We don't have to go back and get it. But remember when the king of Egypt was going to go fight? He was going to go fight the king of Assyria. Do y'all remember what he told Josiah? Before Josiah went out and tried to fight him?
He said, turn back around. My beef and I with you. God told me to come up and take this nation.
He said, Yah told me to come up and take this nation. Right? So now what he's done is he's gone and he's taken tribute after Josiah died. Remember, he killed Josiah. His people killed Josiah. Josiah dressed up as if he wasn't the king, though. Right? But he ended up dying at the hands of the Pharaoh Necho trying to fight against him. Right? So now his son takes over. 3 months into his reign, what'd he do? He take it over. He said, yo, Jehoahaz, you got to give me money. You got to pay tribute. Jehoahaz said, okay, I'm going to pay tribute. But he start exacting taxes over the people. So if he say, how much was it? 500? Shekels of silver?
100 talents of silver and 1 talent of gold.
Okay, so it was 100 talents of silver and 1 talent of gold. So what Jehoahaz did is he said, okay, we're going to break this down. Everybody in Judah got to pay a little something to go towards this as a tax, to go towards what's being paid to the king of Egypt. So he would just forward that money over to the king of Egypt. The king of Egypt would get it, right? Only 3 months in, he said, you know what? No. He took him and put him in prison in Egypt. And then he placed his brother in the king instead of him. His brother's name was Eliakim. Right? He changed his brother's name from Eliakim to Jehoiakim. Right? He changed his name from Eliakim to Jehoiakim, which would be the same as Yahuakim. So he changed his name from just God to Yahuwah, right? Put Yahuwah in his name. That's important to understand because Necho felt that he was talking. He got a message from the Most High God, right? And when he said, look, Most High God is telling me to go fight the king of Assyria. This battle is not for you. He was right about that, right? So the Most High God may have actually been dealing with him through a prophet or something. He may have actually been dealing with him. We don't have no a whole lot of book, at least not that I've noticed. We ain't got no book on it. But he may have actually been dealing with this guy, and that may be why he look at him and he say, nah, I want you to be called Yahuakim as opposed to Eliakim, which is the same name. It just takes God. It changes God to Yahuwah, his actual name. No, that's just, I don't know why the TV do it all the whole time. Don't keep going. Go to Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 1. It's going to be a little confusing because there's a lot of name changes between these kings that we're about to read. But I want y'all to kind of take a look at this. I'm going to try to zoom in on this one too.
The words of Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, of the priests that were in Anathoth in the land of Benjamin, mm-hmm. to whom the word of Yahuwah came in the days of Josiah, the son of Ammon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign.
Right? So you have Jeremiah, who's also prophesying in the same time period. Right? Keep going.
It came also in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, unto the end of the 11th year of Zedekiah, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, unto the king.
Now he's telling you, it comes with Josiah and Jehoiakim, right? All the way to Zedekiah. So he's talking about this same time period that we're talking about right now, right? Jump over to Jeremiah chapter 22. Verse 1. All right, I want y'all to kind of look at this. If you look at the screen, you got Jehoahaz. He comes from Josiah. Then the king of Egypt put his brother on the stand. So, put his brother on the kingdom, right? And he named him Jehoiakim as opposed to Eliakim, which was his name before. Let's see, this is Jeremiah chapter 22, verse 1.
Thus says Yahuwah, go down to the king of Judah and speak there this word, and say, hear the word of the Lord, O king of Judah, that sittest upon the throne of David, thou and thy servants and thy people that enter in by these gates. Thus says Yahuwah, execute judgment and righteousness, and deliver the spoil out of the hand of the oppressor. No wrong, do no violence to the stranger, the fatherless, nor the widow, neither shed innocent blood in this place. For if you do this thing indeed, then shall there enter in by the gates of this house king sitting upon the throne of David, riding in chariots and on horses, he and his servants, his people.
But if you will not, right? So he's telling them, listen, all you got to do is treat the people right, keep my commandments, essentially, right? And if you do that, then the kings of Judah will continue, is what he's saying. Right. You'll continue to have kings of Judah that enter in through these gates. But watch this.
But if you will not hear these words, I swear by myself, says Yahuwah, that this house shall become a desolation. For thus says Yahuwah unto the king's house of Judah, thou art Gilead unto me, and thou art in the head of Lebanon. Yet surely I will make thee a wilderness and cities which are not inhabited. And I will prepare destroyers against thee, everyone with his weapons, and they shall cut down thy choice cedars. Cast them into the fire. And many nations shall pass by the city, and they shall say every man to his neighbor, wherefore has Yahuwah done this unto this great city? Then they shall answer, because they have forsaken the covenant of Yahuwah their God, and worshiped other gods and served them. Weep ye not for the dead, neither bemoan him, but weep sore for him that goes away, for he shall return no more, nor see his native country. For thus says Yahuwah, touching Shallum, the son of Josiah, king of Judah.
The son of who?
The son of Josiah, king of.
So he calls him Shallum here, right? But this is the same king Jehoahaz. Read it again. What verse is that? 10? 11? Read 11 again. Read 10.
For thus says Yahuwah, touching Shallum, the son of Josiah, king of Judah.
Uh-huh.
Which reigned in the stead of Josiah, his father, which sent forth out of this place. He shall not return there anymore. But he shall die in the place.
He said he shall not return there anymore. But what's going to happen?
He shall die in the place where they had led him captive, and shall see this land no more.
So the prophecy of Jeremiah was saying that Jehoaz, who's being called Shallum here, he's going to, baby girl, you got to back up, right? He's going to end up dying in Egypt, right? Keep going.
Well, to him that buildeth his house by unrighteousness and his chambers by wrong. That uses his neighbor's service without wages and gives him for his work. Thus saith, I will build me a wide house and large chambers, and cutteth him out windows, and it is siled with cedar and painted with vermilion. Shall thou reign because thou closest thyself in cedar? Did not thy father eat and drink and do judgment and justice? And then it was well with him. He judged
right.
The poor.
We don't have to get no more of that one. Right. So this is prophesying many of the kings that we're about to read about. Right. So now let's jump back. Let's go back to. Let me see here. Let's go back to Jeremiah chapter 1. Give me verse 4. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 4.
Then the word of Yahuwah came unto me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou came forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee. And
I ordained. Now, a lot of people have heard this, right? We've heard this in the Christian church. A lot of people look at it and they say, you know what? God is talking about me when he say this. But that's not true. When they quote this, this is what the Most High God, this is the introduction of Jeremiah to us as a prophet. This is what the Most High God gave to Jeremiah as prophecy, right? So he's telling Jeremiah, I'm choosing you for this purpose. I knew who you was when you was in the belly, right? Keep going. Watch this.
Then said I, ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child.
Right? So this is Jeremiah's response to God. He's documenting a interaction that he had with God. He's telling them, I know you want me to be a prophet, but I can't really speak like that. I'm just a kid. I'm young. Right? Watch this.
But Yahuwah said unto me, say not I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Mm-hmm. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith Yahuwah.
Mm-hmm.
Then Yahuwah put forth his hand and touched my mouth, and Yahuwah said unto me, behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over kingdoms to root out and to pull down, to destroy, throw down, build and to plant. Moreover, the word of Yahuwah came unto me, saying, Jeremiah, what seest thou? And I said, I see a rod of an almond tree. Then said Yahuwah unto me, thou hast well seen, for I will hasten my word to perform it. And the word of Yahuwah came unto me the second time, saying, what seest thou? And I said, I see a seething pot, and the face thereof is toward the north. And Yahuwah said unto me, out of the north, and evil shall bring forth upon the inhabitants of the land. For lo, I will call all the families of the kingdoms of the earth, says Yahuwah, and they shall come, and they shall set every one his throne at the entering gates of Jerusalem, and against all the walls thereof round about, and against all the cities of Judah. And I will utter my judgments against them, touching all their wickedness who have forsaken me, and have burnt incense unto other gods, and worshipped the works of their own hands. Thou therefore, gird up thy loins, and arise, and speak to them all that I command thee. Be not dismayed at their faces, lest I confound thee before them. For behold, I have made thee this day a defense city, and an iron pillar, and brazen walls against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, against princes thereof, against priests thereof, and against the people of the land. They shall fight against thee, prevail against thee, for I am with thee, says Yahuwah, to deliver thee.
Right. So the Most High God is preparing Jeremiah to take on all these nations with prophecy. Right. So he showed him a couple visions. He asked him, what'd you see? Right. He is like, yeah, man, I saw the rod of an almond tree. In other words, like a branch of an almond tree. And he showed another. And he said, man, I see a seed pot. And he told him, yeah, you saw well. He said, all the nations, right? All the nations. In other words, all the nations about to be boiled. You know what I'm saying? What he really saying. But he said, all the nations are going to come up and set up their seats right outside Israel, right outside Judah. He is like, and there, I'm going to judge every one of them for everything they've been doing, including burning the idols and making sacrifices to idols. Right? So he's just letting you know that's in the few. He talking about the battle of Armageddon when he say that. Right? Keep going.
Moreover, the word of Yahuwah came to me, saying, go and cry in the ear of Jerusalem, saying, thus says Yahuwah, I remember thee, the kindness of thy youth, the love of thine espousals, when thou wantest after me in the wilderness, in the land that was not sown. Israel was holiness unto Yahuwah, and the fruit, first fruits of his increase. All that devour him shall offend. Evil shall come upon them, says Yahuwah. Hear ye the word of Yahuwah, O house of Jacob, and all the families of the house of Israel. Thus says the Lord, what iniquity have your fathers found in me, that they are gone far from me, and have walked after vanity, and become so vain?
Right? So the Most High is asking a question. He's saying, I just want to understand. What did I do wrong to justify your ancestors that completely turned their back on me and they walked against me? He like, what did I do wrong? What, show me what my fault is. What sin did I commit? Right? That's what Yahuwah is asking us. Right? Watch this. Keep going.
Neither said they, where is Yahuwah that brought us out of the land of Egypt, that led us through the wilderness, through a land of deserts and pits, through a land of drought and of shadow of death, through a land of no man passed through, and where no man dwelt. I also brought you into a plentiful country to eat the fruit thereof and the goodness thereof. But when ye entered, ye defiled my land and made my inheritance an abomination. The priest said not, where is the Lord? And they that handle the law knew me not. The pastors also transgressed against me, and the prophets prophesied by Baal and walked after things that do not profit. Wherefore, I will yet plead with you, says Yahuwah, and with your children's children will I plead. For pass over the isles of Chittim and see, and send unto Kedar and consider diligently and see if there be such a thing.
All right, he said, look, go into these other nations and see if you see anything like it, where people just disrespect their God. Watch this, keep going.
Has a nation changed their gods, which are yet no gods? But my people have changed their glory for that which does not profit.
Right? He said, look, these other nations don't even have real gods. And they stick to them. They committed to their fake stuff. He's like, but y'all got a real God, and y'all change it for stuff that's not God. Right? He's just trying to show us that what we do makes zero sense. Right? Keep going.
Be astonished, O ye heavens, and be horribly afraid. Be very desolate, says Yahuwah. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewn them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. Is Israel a servant? Is he a homeborn slave?
Why? Right. Is he a servant? Is he a homeborn slave? He trying to tell you what's going to end up happening to us. Right. That's why he put us in slavery in all the nations. It don't matter what nation we were sent to, we became slaves there. Sent to different places in Europe as slaves. The Middle East as slaves. Right? To South America as slaves. Mexico as slaves. North America as slaves. Right? All these different places we went as slaves. Right? In Asia as slaves. All right, keep going. He says, is Israel a homeboy servant? All right, keep going.
Why is he spoiled? The young lions roared upon him and yelled, and they made his land waste. His cities are burnt without inhabitant. Also the children of Noph and Tephanes have broken the crown of thy head. Hast thou not procured this unto thyself? Is that thou hast, in that thou hast forsaken Yahuwah thy God when he led thee by the way? And now what hast thou to do in the way of Egypt? To drink the waters of Sihor? Or what hast thou to do in the way of Assyria to drink the waters of the river? Thine own wickedness shall correct thee, and thine backslide shall reprove thee. Know therefore and see that it is an evil thing and bitter that thou hast forsaken Yahuwah thy God, and that my fear is not in thee, says Yahuwah, God of hosts. For out of old time I have broken thy yoke and burst thy bands. And thou, I will not transgress when upon every high hill and on every green tree thou wanderest playing the harlot. Yet I have planted thee a noble vine, holy, a right seed. How then art thou turned into the degenerate plant of a strange vine to me? For though thou wash thee with nitre and take thee much soap, yet thine iniquity is marked before me, says Yahuwah God. How can thou say, I am not polluted? I have not gone after Baalim. See thy way in the valley. Know what thou hast done. Thou art a swift dromedary reversing her ways. A wild donkey used in the wilderness that snuffeth up the wind at her pleasure. In her occasion, who can turn her away? All weary themselves in her month, they shall find her. Withhold thy foot from being unshod, and thy throat from thirst. But thou said, there is no hope. No, for I have loved strangers, and after them will I go. As the thief is ashamed when he is found, so is the house of Israel ashamed. They, their kings, their princes, and their priests, and their prophets, saying to a stock, thou art my father, and to a stone, thou hast brought me forth. For they have turned their back unto me, and not their face. But in the time of their trouble, they will say, arise and save us. But where are thy gods that thou hast made thee? Let them arise if they can save thee in the time of thy trouble. For according to the number of thy cities are thy gods, O Judah. Wherefore will I plead? Wherefore will you plead with me? Transgressed against me, says Yahuwah. In vain have I smitten your children. They receive no correction. Your own sword has devoured your prophets like a destroying lion. O generation, see ye the word of Yahuwah. Have I been a wilderness to Israel, a land of darkness? Wherefore say my people, we are lords. We will come no more unto thee. Can a maid forget her ornaments or a bride her attire? Yet my people have forsaken me days without number. Why trimmest thou thy way to love? Therefore thou hast also taught the wicked ones thy ways. Also in thy skirts is found the blood of the souls of the poor. In I have not found it by secret search, but upon all these. Yet thou sayest, because I am innocent, surely his anger shall turn from me. Behold, I will plead with thee, because thou sayest, I have not sinned. Why gaddest thou about so much to change thy way? Thou also shalt be ashamed of Egypt, as thou wast ashamed of Assyria. Yea, thou shalt go forth from in thy hands upon thine head with the Lord. For the Lord has rejected thy confidences, and thou shalt not prosper in them.
So we thought Egypt could save us. Right. So that's why that had to happen to Shallum. Right. To Jehoahaz. Because the Most High God put a prophecy before that into Jeremiah saying, oh, and y'all thought you thought Egypt was going to save you. Well, Egypt is going to take you now. Right. So then he showed that with Jehoahaz. Jehoahaz is in right after Josiah. Egypt takes him. He takes him as prisoner 3 months after into his reign. And then he puts another king in place. Right. Let's go to chapter 3.
Mm-hmm.
Let's look at chapter 3.
They say if a man put away his wife and she go from him and become another man's, turn unto her again.
Right. He said, if a man commit adultery.
No. If a man put away his wife.
I was just talking to a brother yesterday. He is like, it's unlawful for a man to take his wife back after she commit adultery. I was like, okay. So how David do it? And he is called blameless. He's like, oh, no, see, brother, David, I forgot what example he used, but he thought I was talking about something else. He was like, he thought I was talking about something else. I was like, nah. Oh, he thought I was talking about Bathsheba. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, no. I'm not talking about Bathsheba. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, no. Look at my call. You know what I'm saying? And after that, brother didn't say nothing else. He was quiet. He is confident. He is arguing with everybody in there. I was like, I ain't even trying to argue with you. I just want you to answer a question for me. You know what I'm saying? But he quiet after that. And that's what happens. Right? These brothers think they know the law. Now listen, Jeremiah knows the law. So look how he said it. He didn't say nothing about adultery. He says, what happened? Say it again.
If a man put away his wife and she go far from him and become another man, shall he return unto her again?
Mm-hmm.
Shall not that land be greatly polluted?
Mm-hmm.
The harlot with many lovers, yet return again unto me, says Yahuwah. Lift up thine eyes unto the high places and see where thou hast not been lying with. In the ways hast thou sat for them as the Arabian in the wilderness. Thou hast polluted the land with thy whoredoms and thy wickedness. Therefore, mm-hmm. the flowers have been withholden, and there hath been no latter rain. Thou hast a whore's forehead. Thou refusest to be ashamed. Will thou not from this time cry unto me, my father, thou art a guide of my youth? He reserved it ever. Will he keep it to the end? Behold, thou hast spoken and done evil things as thou couldest. The Lord said unto me in the days of Josiah the king, as I've seen which backsliding Israel has done, she is up on every high and under every green tree, and there has played the harlot. I said, after she had done all these things, turn thou unto me, but she returned not. And her treacherous sister Judah saw it. And I saw when for all the causes whereby backsliding Israel committed adultery, I had put her away and given her a bill of divorce. Yet her treacherous sister Judah feared not, but went and played the harlot also. And it came to pass through the lightness of her whoredom that she defiled the land and committed adultery with stones and with stocks. And yet for all this, her treacherous sister Judah has not turned unto me with her whole heart, but fringedly saith the Lord. And the Lord said unto me, the backsliding Israel has justified herself more than treacherous Judah. Go and proclaim words toward the north and say, return, thou backsliding Israel, says Yahuwah. And I will not cause my anger to fall upon you, for I am merciful, says Yahuwah, and I will not keep anger forever. Only acknowledge thy iniquity, that thou hast transgressed against Yahuwah thy God, and hast scattered thy ways to the strangers under every green tree, and ye have not obeyed my voice, says Yahuwah. Turn to backsliding children, says Yahuwah, for I am married unto you, and I will take you one of a city and two of a family, and I will bring you to Zion, and I will give you pastors according to my heart, which shall feed you with knowledge. And it shall come to pass when you abide and increase in the land of those days, says Yahuwah. They shall say no more the ark of the covenant of Yahuwah. Neither shall they come to mind, neither shall they remember it, neither shall they visit it, neither shall that be done anymore.
So read that again.
And it shall come to pass when you be multiplied and increased in the land of those days, says Yahuwah, they shall say no more the ark of the covenant of Yahuwah.
They shall say no more the ark of the covenant of Yahuwah. The Most High God meant what he said. Remember, just in last week's fellowship call, we was talking about the ark of the covenant. Sister Sharon, she asked, she's like, so where is the ark of the covenant now? And we was talking about how the Ethiopians, baby girl, Zakai, relax. Y'all go play downstairs or do something. Right. We asked the question, where's the Ark of the Covenant? We talk about how the Ethiopians claim that they have it. Right. But this was intentional. Most High God said, oh, no, it's going to be a day. I'm going to light y'all up. Ain't nobody going to say nothing about the Ark of the Covenant.
Revelation will tell you that the Ark comes down out of heaven from where the Most High is.
Huh?
It's in Revelation to tell you it comes down out of heaven from where the Most High is.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the only mention that we see of it. Right, when it come down from out of heaven. All right, keep going. But in Revelation, that's talking about Yahushua.
At that time, they shall call Jerusalem the throne of Yahuwah, and all the nations shall be gathered unto it to the name of Yahuwah, to Jerusalem. Neither shall they walk any more after the imagination of their evil heart. In those days, the house of Judah shall walk with the house of Israel. They shall come together out of the land of the north to the land that I have given for an inheritance to your fathers. But I said, how shall I put thee among the children and give thee a pleasant land, a goodly heritage of the host of nations? And I said, thou shalt call me my father and shall not turn away from me. Surely as a wife treacherously departs from her husband, so have you dealt treacherously with me. O house of Israel, says Yahuwah, a voice was heard upon the high places, weeping and supplications of the children of Israel, for they have perverted their way. And they have forgotten Yahuwah their God. Return, ye backsliding children, and I will heal your backslidings. Behold, we come unto thee, for thou art Yahuwah our God. Truly in vain is salvation hoped for from the hills and from the multitude of mountains. Truly in Yahuwah our God is the salvation of Israel. For shame has devoured the labor of the fathers from our youth, their flocks and their herds, sons and their daughters. We lie down in our shame, and our confusion covers us. For we have sinned against Yahuwah God, and we our fathers from our youth, even unto this day, and have not obeyed the voice of Yahuwah our God.
Mm-hmm. So you see, Jeremiah is laying it out. He's laying out the case. And this is what he do for the first few chapters. He lay out the case against us. Right? He makes it very plain and very clear. You know what I'm saying? Then he moves on, you know what I'm saying, when you get into maybe chapter, well, really he do it throughout the whole book, but he started moving on to some other types of prophecy after a couple chapters, right? So we gonna stop right there, but next week we gonna continue on and we gonna look at some of the other kings and we gonna look at some of the prophecies that have to do with those kings. But then we gonna have to deal with some of the other prophets. So let me go back here and then we gonna zoom in. Right. So if we look at the prophets here, right, we read Nahum. Did we touch Joel?
No.
Grab real quick. Let's grab Joel. Give me chapter one. Yeah, we got to touch Joel. Give me Joel chapter 1. All right, because we know Zephaniah was talking about, you know what I'm saying, Most High God going to reach out against Assyria. And then Nahum telling us pretty much the same thing, right? That he going to set up Assyria. Then Habbakkuk, he wasn't talking about Assyria. He was talking about Babylon was going to come. He asked the question, like, how you keep letting this happen, right? But let's look at Joel. This is Joel chapter 1, verse 1.
The word of Yahuwah that came to Joel, the son of Pethuel. Hear this, ye old men, and give ear, all ye inhabitants of the land. Hath this been in your days, or even in the days of your fathers? Tell ye your children of it, and let your children tell their children, and their children another generation. That which the palmer worm has left, hath the locust eaten.
And that he said, that which the palmer worm has left, the locust came and ate. Watch this.
And that which the locust had left, the cankerworm came and has eaten.
Everything the locust left over, the cankerworm came and got.
And that was the worm had left, the caterpillar eaten.
And anything that the cankerworm left, the caterpillar came and got it. Right? So he's talking about all these nations that keep taking us over. Right? We have Assyria. Now we about to have Babylon, and it's going to be more after that. Right? Keep going.
Awake, ye drunkards, and weep and howl, all ye drunkards of wine, because of the new wine, for it is cut off from your mouth. For a nation is come up to my land strong and without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and has the cheek teeth of a great lion. He that laid the vine waste and barked my fig tree have made it clean, bare, and cast it away. The branches thereof are made white. Lament like a virgin girded with sackcloth for the husband of her youth. The meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord, the priests, the Lord's.
Right. Ministry. So now look at what he's saying. He's saying it's going to be a nation. They're going to be a mean nation. They're going to clean this thing up. Right. You could tell he's not talking about the Assyrians. He's talking about the Babylonians. He's talking about the same people that Habbakkuk was. Right. But then look what he says next. Read that last one again.
He has laid vine waste and barked my fig tree. He has made it clean, bare, and cast it away. The branches thereof are made white. Lament like a virgin girded with sackcloth for the husband of her youth. The meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord, the priests, the Lord's ministers mourn.
Right, he said the meat offering and the drink offering are cut off. He said the priests, the ministers are going to mourn. Right? Now, at the time when they're hearing this, they probably don't know what this means. They're like, what you mean? Why would it be cut off? Right. But what he's telling you is the temple is going to be destroyed. This is the first hint that he's given at the destruction of the temple that's coming. Right. Keep going.
The field is wasted. The land mourneth. The corn is wasted. The new wine is girded up, is dried up. The oil languisheth. Be ye ashamed, O ye husbandmen, howl, O ye vine dressers, for weep for the barley, because the harvest of the field is perished. The fig tree languisheth. The pomegranate tree and the palm tree also. The apple tree, even the trees of the field, are withered, because joy is withered away from the sons of men. Gird yourselves and lament, ye priests. Howl, ye ministers of the altar. Come lie at night in sackcloth, ye ministers of God. For the meat offering and the drink offering is withholden from the house of your God. Sanctify ye a fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the elders and the inhabitants of the land into the house of Yahuwah. Cry unto Yahuwah. Alas, for the day of Yahuwah is at, and destruction from the Almighty shall come. Is not the meat cut off before our eyes? Yea, joy and gladness from the house of our God. The seed is rotten under their clods. The gardeners are laid desolate. The barns are broken down, for the corn is withered. How do the beasts groan? The herds of the cattle are perplexed, because they have no pasture. Yea, the flocks and sheep are made desolate. O Lord, to thee will I cry, for fire has devoured the pastures of the wilderness. The flame has burnt the trees of the field. The beasts of the field cry also unto thee, for the rivers of waters are dried up, and the fire has devoured the pastures of the wilderness.
All right. So we see that he's prophesying the destruction of Judah. So you look at the prophets at this time. Some of them are talking about Assyria. Some of them is talking about Babylon coming up. Some of them is talking about Judah being destroyed. Right? All these are prophets coming up in one time period. Right? All under, mostly under one king. Right? And there's a message going out. The people are supposed to hear this and be like, whoa, 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 whoa. Let's take a step back. Let's reconsider some things. But we're going to talk about in the coming weeks how that didn't happen. Right? We close now to the end of Judah. Right? And then we're going to have to take a 70-year break. Then the Most High God going to bring us back. We're going to read about all of it. Okay? Any questions? Nope. Of course, you don't have no darn questions. I'll hit you in your chin. Say something else. Let me see. Any questions in the chat? No. Joel 99. What's your 99? You mean 19? Read 19. Is that where it said that sacrifices are cut off? Is that what it is, T?
Joel, what?
19. Is that where it said the sacrifices is cut off?
Let's see. Hold on. Yeah. 19.
Yeah, so go ahead and read it out loud. Sister Pamela is asking, does this mean no more sacrifices?
The meat offering and drink offering is cut off from the Lord, the priest, the Lord, the ministers mourn. Yes.
It'd yeah. So what we gonna read is we gonna read exactly how this plays out. But if you look on the screen here, let's pull up the screen. So if you look on the screen here, we gonna get to this point, and the temple is gonna be destroyed by Babylon. So Babylon is gonna destroy the temple. When there's no temple, then there's no sacrifice. Right, there's no way for the priest to sacrifice. So when this happens, we're gonna read prophecy about how the priest. We're gonna read a book called Lamentations, right? And we're gonna see how everyone was so upset about this because our temple was destroyed. Then we're gonna fast forward, and our people are gonna end up coming back, right? So and then when our people come back, we're gonna see that they mourn because the temple ain't even in the original state, right? So, yes, that's what that means. It's saying no more sacrifices, but it's not saying no more sacrifices as in sacrifices are illegal and we can never sacrifice again. He's saying that he didn't say it explicitly there, but the prophecy is referring to the fact that the destruction of the temple is coming. And once the temple is destroyed, the priest can't make a sacrifice. Right. They can't do sacrifices anymore once the temple is destroyed. Does that make sense? Any other questions? Let me know if that makes sense or if that answers the questions for you. All right. If there's no more questions, then and y'all can always bring the questions to the fellowship hour also if you got questions. If you want to join us for fellowship hour, reach out. I'll give you the information so you can join. And we also have a kind of little chat community or whatever it is. If you want to join that, go ahead and reach out to me and we can get you in. That said, let's go ahead and pray out.